Good morning, Johnson. Would you stand as we read our call to worship? Praise the Lord, all you who fear him. For he has not ignored those who suffer, nor turned from those in need. Praise the Lord, all you who fear him. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, you are merciful and mighty, always worthy of our greatest acts of praise. We gather now in Christ's name, and led by the Holy Spirit, we join in Christ's song. This moment, as are all moments, is yours. You are here, and we are yours. Open our hearts to the Spirit's transforming work, that as our song aligns with Christ's, so too would our lives. In the name of Jesus, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit. Amen.
You are the everlasting God. trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? No, see how great is our God.
Lord, the cry of our heart is to bring you praise. Everything we do, every thought, every action is to bring you praise. Lord, as your word is spoken to us this morning, as your word is proclaimed through art and culture and talents and gifts that you've given us to bring you praise, Lord, speak, and may we have an open heart to listen this morning. In Jesus' name, we all pray. Amen.
John 9, 1 through 12. As Jesus was going along, he came across a man who was born blind. His disciples asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born like this?" But he told them that neither him nor his parents sinned. This man is like this so that the work of God could be displayed in his life. As long as it's day, we have to do the work of the one who sent me, because night is coming when no one can do any work. But as long as I'm in the world, I am the light of the world. So then Jesus spat in the ground and mixed up some mud and put it over the blind man's eyes and told him, "Go and wash off at the pool of Siloam." So the man went, he washed, and then he came home seeing. Some of the people who knew him or had seen him around started asking themselves, "Isn't this the guy who used to sit and beg?" Some claimed that it was, but others claimed, no, it only looks like that guy. But he himself insisted, yeah, I'm that guy. And so, then how is it that your eyes are opened? They asked him. "Well, a man they call Jesus," he said, "came, made some mud to put over my eyes and told me to go wash off. And then, so I went and I washed and I came home seeing." "Well, where is he now?" they asked him. "I don't know." The word of the Lord.
Good morning. As you know, this semester, after spending some time looking at what Jesus had to say regarding how our life ought to look, lived out a life of praise in his great assembly, after spending time studying what Jesus had to say in the Sermon on the Mount regarding that, last week we made a turn, and we began looking at these small encounters that Jesus had in Scripture. In the Gospels with people, where he in some way invites them into the great assembly. So last week we looked at the story of Nicodemus and the story of the Samaritan woman. We just heard the text read part of the story of Jesus' encounter with the blind man in John 9. What we're going to do with that text this morning, with John 9, is not like an exegetical sermon where we'll kind of dig into it and try to unearth things from the text. Rather, we're going to do similar to what we did last fall with Mandy Harvey, the jazz singer, when she came and told her story and shared her art with us. And we just really heard a story. And that's what we're going to do this morning. We're going to hear and see the story of our friend Francisco. And I think in hearing his story, something of the text will be unearthed for us. I think it'll be illuminated in some way, brought into our world in some way. So we're going to interview Francisco here in just a minute, but I'm not going to be the one doing the interviewing. Alicia Crumpton is going to do the interview. Alicia, if you don't know, Dr. Crumpton is the head of our PhD program here at Johnson. She does an unbelievable job, but she does it from Phoenix, Arizona, most of the time. So you may not have seen her before or met her, so I want to just tell you just a little bit about her. And the number one thing I want to tell you is that she is wonderfully eccentric, an absolute free spirit. One of my favorite things each semester, I send out like some open dates and texts to the faculty and say, "Hey, if anybody wants to preach this semester, you know, here are the dates, here are the texts." And Alicia will respond back often with an email that begins, "Bill, this is a crazy idea, but what if we..." Or, "This might be out of left field, but..." And sometimes I read it and I go, "It's out of left field. I'm just going to file that one away, pretend like I didn't see that." But then other times, something about it grabs me, and I go, "Well, what if? Let's see. Let's try." And this morning was one of those. Francisco is a friend of Alicia's, and so I said, "Let's see." So I'm going to hand the mic over to her, and we'll see.
Well, with that introduction, it's pretty low expectation. I think he's been talking with my husband, because my husband says I'm the queen of big flipping ideas, so we'll see. When I'm not doing my day job with doctoral students, I'm a street art enthusiast, street art and graffiti. I go around the world, really, photographing street artists. And in the city of Phoenix, we have a rich street art culture. And it's just something I'm really passionate about because I think, you know, our first introduction to God is God as creator. And so via our artists and the aesthetic that they put on the streets, I think that they communicate things to us. So when Bill sent out the email, I saw that passage. I got really excited. So one of these BFI sort of came into my head where I thought, I've always thought of this passage as the street art passage because we have a creator, took clay, molded clay, put it on the eyes, and that brought salvation. And so we have the viewer, the artist and the viewer working in tandem through a salvation experience, a conversion experience. And we have other parts of the story that we'll get to. So I thought, well, what if I brought my friend Francisco, who has his own conversion experience and experiences with art, as a way of sort of unpacking this scripture. So let me introduce Francisco. He's an amazing fellow. I knew of his art before I knew him personally on the streets of Phoenix. He's been doing illegal graph and street art, then legal graph and street art. And I should clarify some terms. Many people think that graph and street art is all illegal and it comes from gangs. That's not really the case. Historically, graph and street art emerge out of hip hop and skateboard culture. And whether it's legal or not depends on the city that you live in. And we happen to live in a city that embraces the art community, and we have a vibrant street art community. Here in Knoxville, there's at least a couple of really good alleys that I've found where you can also go visit, and if anybody's interested in that, I can point you to that, or we can do a little field trip. But Francisco started out doing graph and street art, and since then, he has won a number of awards. He won the Best Artist Award in Los Angeles for urban art. He's won the Mayor's Art Award in Phoenix. He's won the Vishal Award in the Phoenix Art Museum. He's been invited to speak with congressmen and at the White House with regard to the use of art in community spaces as a way of serving and giving voice to the underprivileged youth in our communities. And he is an artivist, which is a term that the street art community embraces as someone who speaks on the behalf of the marginalized. And that's another aspect of the scripture about what Jesus did for the least of these in healing. His latest fun thing that he did last year is he took a 10-city tour in Europe with other Christian graph and street artists to do paint and spread Jesus' word throughout those cities. So, Francisco,
yeah.
Please come. Welcome to Johnson.
Hello. Thank you.
He is a dear friend of Johnny and mine, and we love having him in our home, and he's done a mural at our house, and I just want to welcome you to Johnson.
Thank you. Hello, everyone.
So, Francisco, to start, this passage begins with a conversion story. Jesus molded that clay and put him on the eyes, and that man could see. And so I thought it might be fun for you to just tell us your story and how art, that creative power, has played a role in your life and who you are today.
Sure. Good morning, everyone. It's an honor to be here. I want to thank Alicia and the staff for having us. So when I was a little kid, I was about 4 years old, and I used to like watching Spider-Man and X-Men and all of the comic book superhero cartoons. And so that's when I started to draw. And throughout school, I just kept drawing. I never really got introduced to painting because we had low resources in our schools at the time in Los Angeles, California. During the 90s, it was kind of like a pretty chaotic time because there was a lot of gang violence in Los Angeles. There was a lot of gangs, and I witnessed a lot of drive-bys and a lot of shootings, and so it was almost like a war zone. And so when I moved to Phoenix, Arizona, I had no family there, I had no friends. It's not what it is today. Today it's, I believe it's one of the top five largest cities or fastest growing cities. It was not the case 10 years ago. It was just cornfields. And I didn't have a car. And so I got into graffiti and hip hop because I've always liked, you know, the skateboarding culture and the hip hop culture. So that led me to eventually getting in trouble with the streets and the law using graffiti. Long story short, I got involved with a few mentors that didn't look like me, and a lot of stereotypes broke culturally, and she introduced, my mentor Judy Boutine introduced me to public art, and that's when I started getting into muralism, and that really encouraged me to want to learn more about my culture. And I did my first study abroad trip in Mexico and started learning about muralism and social justice. That's when I started reading about the scriptures, and God started showing me a passion for the immigrant and loving your neighbor as yourself and loving people and just looking at the intention of the heart in people and not really the outward appearance. And eventually that led me to going to school to study painting and fine arts.
When we were talking on the way here, you shared a story about the illegal part of your graph life when you were incarcerated for a few days, which is the custom when you're arrested for graph work. And you told a story about people standing in a circle in prison. Why don't you share that story with everyone?
Sure. When I went to jail for graffiti, I ended up in Sheriff Jorah Pyle's tent city. And it was a really horrible place. They treat humans like animals. And but when I was in there, God showed me something, and it really stuck with me. He showed me two things. He showed me that people that were in the jail weren't bad people. They just made bad decisions. And the other thing was, you know, there was a lot of segregation within the jail. So when somebody goes to jail or prison, they ask you what race you come from. And so there's white, there's black, and then there's like the brown people. They have two sections. They have the Mexican Americans or the people that were born here in the United States. And then they have people that are from south of the border. And so my parents are from Mexico, and I identify as both because I embrace both cultures. I acculturated to both cultures. And so when the guy asked me, he's like, are you Mexican or are you like Mexican-American? And I look over and there's a small crowd in the Mexican side and a big crowd in the Mexican-American side. So I'm like, I'm Mexican-American. And so I feel like we're all the same, so I don't like segregation, but I was forced to, you know, follow their rules. And then I noticed that in one of the nights, there was a big circle of people, and they were from different races and cultures and backgrounds, and they were all holding hands, and they were all praying. And that just really moved me because in that whole, like, jail, I didn't see God move like he moved and the people, and just seeing the unity and the solidarity between all these different people, different backgrounds, coming together in faith, it just, I don't know, it really moved me, and I'll never forget that.
Was there a single moment or a set of experiences that sort of led to your conversion and saying, I'm all in for Jesus?
Mm-hmm. I think this was in the beginning, and around 2003, 2004, I was a senior in high school. When I had moved down there to Phoenix, I was a junior, and I was getting in trouble. I was getting kicked out of different high schools. I went through four different high schools. I went to the bad kid high school, got kicked out of that one, and I ended up at a charter school. The principal said, Francisco, this is your last chance. This is a brand new school. This is the first year, and if you mess up one time, I'm going to kick you out. And I said, okay. So I did my best, and I barely graduated. And my parents weren't even going to come to my graduation because they didn't believe that I was going to graduate. But during that time, I ended up getting into a fight with another group of graffiti writers. And in the culture of graffiti, there's a couple of different cultures, and there's a culture where people just like to paint. They like to paint letters, they identify with a name, an alias, and they go and they paint murals or they paint their name with their group. But then there's another side of graffiti, and that side could be more of a gang perspective, where if they see writing on a wall that's not in your territory, or maybe your group has some sort of like beef with another group, you're gonna catch that beef. If one of your friends has beef, you have beef no matter what. So back in the days, I used to like to fight and stuff, and I met these guys, and I told them who I was. They told me who they were, and I already knew, like, we're going to fight. So I got off my car, and we started fighting. A second guy came, started fighting with two dudes, and then the third guy came at me with a bottle and smashed a bottle on my head, and then they started pulling out weapons. And that's when I knew, like, I got to get out of here. So I ran, and I got out of that situation. And then I just started thinking, like, is this the lifestyle that I want? Like, because at the time, those type of friends would have gone back and retaliated. But at that moment, I was seeking God. I was raised Catholic, and I didn't know how it felt to be filled with the Holy Spirit. But then I got invited to a youth night. And they were rapping about Jesus, and they were using hip-hop as a tool to share the gospel, and that's what really touched me. I went up for prayer, and I felt the Holy Spirit, and I just remember just falling down, just giving everything to God. And so those experiences led me to that.
How did that that experience and your deciding to follow Jesus, how has that changed how you do art, or has it changed?
I think the way that it changed is that God changes your heart's desires. And so before, I think my desire was to get known and to be famous in my city, and just like do the graffiti and the street life and stuff. And then what God did is, like, I don't know, the desire to go and paint my name and have that rush or that adrenaline, or just other things like going to parties and stuff. It just, those desires changed. And little by little, God started giving me a desire to want to help others, maybe like to be an example onto like youth that were maybe in similar paths. And so that kind of like drives me. That's like my adrenaline. Like when I paint a good mural that brings like some sort of hope or message, and or painting with the community.
I think that's a good segue to the other part of this scripture. So if you read 9:1-41, you have the conversion story. You have the man who was blind and now sees and acknowledges Jesus as who he is. But then you have this other dialogue in there about the Pharisees. And what I love about Jesus is that he gives us these patterns in scripture as a way of telling us who he is and reminding us who he is. And he sets up this comparative with the Pharisees. The Pharisees say, oh, no, not that guy. And Jesus always says, yes, this guy. I am here to heal this guy. The marginalized, the oppressed, the poor, the underprivileged, the least of these. You're the prevailing majority, but I'm here for these people. And so I want to highlight some of your experience as an artivist, someone who speaks for the least of these. He's had a number of murals that have gotten national acclaim, one of which was SB 1070, Who's the Illegal Now?, which was a now famous mural picked up by CNN. It's been featured in books. He's had art featured in movies, and he's a known voice for producing art that speaks to social issues within our community. He serves on the National Council of Young Leaders, which is an advocacy group for the underprivileged youth affecting public policy. He's one of the few people I know who can go into Mayor Stanton, the mayor of Phoenix, office and has an open door and an open voice because he walks the talk. And so I just want you to tell us and share with us your heart for artivism and what that means and why that's important.
I think that for me, artivism is a term that some people that use that are involved in arts and social justice circles or groups. But for me, it's more like a lifestyle. It's something that you live. You know, I'm gonna do art whether I make a living or not. But I decided that I want to be a social entrepreneur and be socially responsible and use my art for the social good. And so, you know, knowing about these different scriptures and the history of different types of oppression and also privileges, we all have different privileges, whether you're white, black, brown, depending on which community you live in, and if you're a woman or a man. And so just knowing those different privileges and learning the social class system and where it came from, it has really helped me to understand my identity within my own culture. And it influenced me to want to learn about other cultures. And so I really believe that by studying the history of art and studying the history of movements, art is always included in every movement. In the 60s, in the Mexican Revolution, they had Mexican muralists creating printmaking pieces of art called linoleum prints through newspaper to spread positive messages to bring change in that country. But the interesting thing was that they were also bringing awareness about what was happening in Germany with the Jews and all the different cultures in Germany as well. And so that really, it sparked a light bulb in me, and it made me realize that we shouldn't only focus within our own culture or our own communities, but also speak out about injustice happening in different communities in our country as well.
Do you care to speculate? You know, one of my curiosities about art is how sort of the aesthetic experience. Why do you think God uses art as a means to communicate in ways that words perhaps don't?
I think art is something special. There's something about like creating. There's a couple of elements that are within art that benefit the human. And I think one of them is it's healing. It's therapeutic. There's research behind it. Especially if somebody has experienced trauma, it helps them to have a stable pattern in their baseline. It just helps them to balance things out and focus. Other than therapy, historically, I think that it's been used, especially during like prehistoric times or like in Mesoamerica. They painted murals in caves and pyramids and different things so that they could communicate and also preserve like their culture and their history. And I think art does that. Like during the Renaissance, there was a time of like the plague and the depression and really tough times. Mm-hmm. And then there was a Renaissance, there was a rebirth of the arts, and there was a movement, and it was live. And that's also what happened during the Mexican Revolution, and it happened during the 60s. It happened during the Chicano movement, and they had Chicano arts and social justice and awareness and solidarity. And then they had it in the Bronx. In the 1970s, they had hip hop, which is now a worldwide movement that was started by youth that lived in America. It was a positive movement. It was to bring people together, to bring community of different backgrounds. So I think art is meant to bring people together, to celebrate, you know, to heal, to show people that we're with you, like you're human. Like when you look at art, it's beauty. When you walk through a neighborhood that maybe was a bad neighborhood or like a scary neighborhood, once it has art and murals, it just changes the vibe and the environment. And yeah, it's more inviting, I think.
So for those of us who are non-artist, quote, non-artist, whatever that means, there may be people out here thinking, well, I'm not really an artist. What could I do? Mm-hmm. What would you say? How would you encourage others who perhaps don't have your gift as a way to get involved and use the creative capacities they have to serve our communities?
I would just encourage, if you don't think you're an artist, just try it. Just try different mediums, be open. You'll find a medium that you really like, whether it's sculpting, photography, screen printing, you know, just try it for fun, or try to connect with an artist in your local community or an art organization. And I would just say, just do it, just practice it. And, you know, there's a lot of benefits to it. And also support your local artists or other artists, because it's a lifestyle for many of us. And it helps when people support us, because then we're able to do this in different parts of, you know, the country or parts of the world. And so that's what I love to do. I love to travel. I've been to 12 countries so far in 20 different states across the United States. And that's what I told God. I said, God, I'm going to let go of the graffiti. But I would really love to travel, paint, and help people. And somehow God has been faithful and connecting me to people like Alicia and other supporters.
So I think what I'm going to do now is I'm going to pray for you, and then I'm going to give you your final words. So okay. Let's pray together.
Yes.
Dear God, our Heavenly Father, I thank you for Francisco, and I thank you for his heart. I thank you, Lord, that you make clay and put on our eyes. And you give us a capacity to see you and to see your heart for the marginalized and the oppressed and the underserved. Lord, I pray for our students and our faculty and our staff and those who are here today, that you give them a heart for the underserved, that you continue to build in them that fire in their belly to advocate, to speak, to create, to argue on behalf of them, if necessary. I thank you, Lord, for Francisco's role and Johnny in my life, that we get to serve together in our community, that we get to uplift one another, and that he came here today to share his testimony. In all things, Lord, we love you and just praise your holy name. Amen.
Amen.
So,
final words. What do you want to share with us about your story, artivism, art, whatever's coming to mind for you?
I would just ask, I would just suggest that you challenge God. And I think it's okay to challenge God and ask God, like, to show us, like, what are some of the things that he wants us to do in this world? Because there's so much hate and division. And I think that, especially in the body of Christ, like, we can shine the light in darkness. And I'm just going to leave you with this scripture. In Exodus chapter 4, Moses encounters God through a burning bush. And God speaks to Moses, and he tells Moses, Moses, what's in your hand? And he tells him, I have a staff. And then he tells Moses, drop it on the floor. And when he drops it to the floor, it turns into a snake. And it says in the word that he was afraid. And then God tells him, okay, Moses, pick up that snake. And he goes in faith and picks up the snake, and it turns back into a staff. He tells him to go tell Pharaoh and to go tell the people that he's God. Later on, in the near future, in that story, he also used the staff in faith to split the was it the Mediterranean Sea or the ocean?
The Red Sea.
I'm sorry. He split the Red Sea in faith to free the people from slavery. He was the first political prophet in the Bible. And he also used the staff to heal people as well. But that staff can also hinder the movement, because he hit the rock because he was prideful. He hit the rock 3 times, and God basically like cursed their journey. So what I'm trying to say is that when I read that scripture, I didn't do this type of art for a living. I didn't go to school. I didn't do portraits. I just did letters. But at the time, God was like, Francisco, what do you have in your hand? Spray can. Drop it. Stop hanging out with those people that you're hanging out with. Drop everything, you know, sacrifice it. Leave it alone. And a couple months later, he said, pick it back up. And he put mentors in my life. He put me in places where I needed to feel uncomfortable. You know, I had to work with people that I didn't normally work with and learn about their cultures and, you know, their perspectives and be open-minded. And so when that happened, I started to realize, you know, this is my staff. This is how God's going to use it. And I've seen how he's used it in a positive way. And I just want to encourage every one of you, like every single one of you have a staff in your hand. Everybody has a talent in here. Like everybody has a great purpose. Like just ask God, what is it that you want me to do with this staff? And just drop it. Just give it to God. And he's going to multiply it. And he's going to take it to a higher place than you could ever take yourself. Like he's just going to bless it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Can you guys stand for me, please? The next song that we're singing is called I Give Myself Away. And in light of his story, it's basically about completely surrendering over to God, like giving yourself to God to glorify him. And for me, it's a really, really emotional song. And it's simple, but it's so powerful. So. Do the closing prayer. Heavenly Father, one day the earth will turn and acknowledge that you are God. People from every nation will bow down before you. In the name of Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, amen. And as you go to love and to serve the Lord, may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Oh, thank you.